Hello, dear chess fans. My name is Eugene Grinis. Welcome to the Eugene Grinis Free Chess School, open for everyone who want to improve own game. In this video, I want to show you a famous game played between two world champions, Mikhail Botvinnik and Jose Capablanca, in Rotterdam, Netherlands, 1938. Mikhail Botvinnik was world champion from 1948 to 1957, from 1958 to 1960, and from 1961 to 1963. By 1938, he had already achieved considerable success at top level, but had yet to establish himself as the challenger to Ali Khan. This tournament was designed to select. Jose Raul Capablanca was one of the greatest players of all time and held the world championship from 1921 to 1927. At one stage of his career, Capablanca lost only one tournament game in 10 years, which gave him an aura of invincibility. He was still an extremely strong opponent in 1938. Just 2 years earlier, he had shared first prize with Botvinnik in the Nottingham tournament, ahead of Ewe, Ali Khan and Laska. However, the format of this tournament, each round in a different city, certainly did not favor the older players, especially those with ailing health. It was the only tournament in his entire career in which he lost more games than he won. D4, knight f6, c4, e6, knight c3, bishop b4. This is the Nemtsov-Indian defense. E3. The Rubinstein variation of the Nemtsov-Indian, one of the most strategically complex openings around, and one where black often gives away the bishop pair to double white pawns. D5. The most common response and belief at the time: establish a central grip with your pawns. Nemtsovich's radical idea of controlling the center from the wings was still in its infancy and distrusted by most strong players of era. Today, Black tends to prefer more flexible setups after castling or c5. D5 was played. A3. Botvinnik's variation of the Rubinstein-Nemtsov-Indian. At that time, this was all relatively new theory. Bishop takes knight check. Pawn takes bishop. C5. Capablanca, always a classical player, decides to fight for the center with his pawns. Black's position is quite satisfactory. His lead in development compensates for White's bishop pair. Cd. In order to open the position for the bishop pair, although the move helps Black free his game as well. Ed. Bishop d3. Black castles. Knight e2. White doesn't develop the knight to f3 because he plans an expansion on the center with f2 f3 and e3 e4. The knight is to be transferred to g3 to help out in this case. B6. Preparing to swap off White's good light squared bishop via a6. Knight c6 was also played. B6. White castles. A4 is also interesting. Bishop a6. Capablanca methodically prepares to exchange off his bishop before it becomes bad, and before its counterpart creates dangerous threats on the king side. The drawback is that after White's reply, Black's knight is poorly placed on a6. Up until this point, both sides have got on with development, and it seems as though Black is doing well, as he succeeds in exchanging off White's superior light squared bishop. However, the dynamics of the pawn break e3 e4 make the issue more complicated. Bishop takes on a6 was played. The immediate f3 gives White a better version. For example, bishop takes bishop, queen takes bishop, rook e8. If knight c6, then e4, better for White. Rook e8, knight g3, knight c6, bishop b2. Also interesting, rook a2. Rook c8, rook e2. Bishop b2, c4, queen d2, as in the game Kasparov-Ivanovich, 1983. Back to the game. Bishop takes on a6 was played. Knight takes bishop. Bishop b2. Queen d3 was Botvinnik's later preference. White would be happy to see c4, as we see later. Queen d3 and queen c8 is passive. Bishop b2 was played. Queen d7. A4. Queen d3 answered by queen a4 could be annoying for white. That's why a4. Rook f e8. White plans a slow central build-up, culminating in a kingside attack. The only way to create a central distraction for white here is to play c takes d, c takes d, rook f c8, intending rook c4, generating sudden queenside counterplay. More importantly, white just doesn't have time to do what he wants in the center. This line that gives black more counterplay is the correct way to play. However, at that time, the power of white's central strategy was underestimated, and Capablanca was probably trying to extract the maximum winning chances from the position. Rook f to e8. Queen d3. C4. Capablanca gains a tempo, but with this move he violates the principle stating don't close the center when attacked on the wing. Botvinnik wrote, this is a really serious positional error. Black evidently assumed that white would be unable to advance the e-pawn later, and black's superiority would tell on the queen side. However, black's superiority on the queen side happens in this case to be of no great consequence, and the breakthrough e3 e4 proves inevitable. Black should have contented himself with a modest defense, queen b7. with a good grip on the E4 square, Capablanca decides to close the center. He has a specific plan in mind. Queen C2. Can you see what Capablanca's deep idea might be? How does he play here? Knight B8. This is the start of the master plan. Black is planning. Knight C6, A5, B3, and eventually Queen takes on E4. Capablanca sees that the B3 square is a potential outpost and that if he lands his knight there, the A4 pawn may fall. However, the knight maneuver takes 4 moves. Rook A1. Botvinnik provokes Capablanca to win the A4 pawn. Knight C6. Black's knight spends a lot of time coming round to B3. And although the A4 pawn does drop, by then white is creating some real threats. Knight G3. Knight A5. Post played. Knight E4 is met by the strange Knight H1, preserving the knight from exchange and preparing F3 followed by the H1 knight's return to the action and the continued central advance. For example, F5, F3, Knight F6, Knight G3 is clearly better for white. The more pieces remain on the board, the more potent white's advantage will be. White will have greater prospects of launching an attack on the black king. Knight A5 was played. F3. Knight B3. E4. Queen takes pawn. Capablanca does indeed win the pawn, but he is also very likely to get mated on the other wing. Black is in deep trouble, and his extra pawn won't be of much assistance to him. E5. Knight D7. Now, Knight B C5 is threatened. White can obviously afford neither an exchange of queens nor a black knight landing on the square D3. The immediate knight C5 fails to rook E2. Leaving both black knights attacked. 97 was played. Queen f2. In order to avoid knight c5 tricks, which allow black's knight back into the fight, white doubles on the f-file with some ideas of bringing the queen to g3 when the knight moves. Also, from here the queen supports the f-pawn's advance. Alternatively, rook e2 was interesting. For example, g6, f4, f5, and a knight sack on f5. Pawn takes knight, queen takes on f5. White is much better here. Back to the game. Queen f2. G6, creating a hook for the white f pawn, but also preventing the knight from coming in. F4, f5. This is forced. Black can't allow white to open the f file. Pawn takes pawn. En passant. White must keep the game open to make his local superiority of force on the king side tell. Anything else and black has time to reposition his d7 knight on e6 via the f8 square. Knight takes pawn. F5. It is now very difficult for black to defend. He tries to do so by exchanging of the rooks on the e-file. Rook takes rook. Rook takes rook. Rook e8. Capablanca reduces material as quickly as possible. It looks logical to exchange of the rooks. Rook to e6. Using the springboard of the f5 pawn to occupy the e6 square is very powerful. Now the exchange of rooks is forced. But not f takes g6. Attacking the knight. H takes g6. And black's knight remains immune on f6. Rook takes rook check. Knight takes rook. And black is okay. Rook e6 was played. Rook takes rook. No choice, since king g7 loses to the shot. Rook takes knight on f6. Let's see. King takes rook. F takes g, check. King takes pawn. Queen f5, check. King g7. Knight h5, check. King h6. What now? H4. Rook g8. G4. Threatening mate in two. Queen c6. Bishop a3. White forces mate in three moves. Queen e8. Queen f4, check. King g6 and queen f6 mate. Back to the party, back to the game. Rook takes rook. Pawn takes rook. King g7. Queen f4 with an ugly threat. White looks to penetrate on the dark squares. Queen e8 was played. Not queen a2, which loses at once. Why? How would you play as white in this position? Please pause the video. White plays knight f5, check. Pawn takes knight. If king h8, then queen b8, check. Knight g8, queen e5, check. Knight f6, the only move. Queen takes knight, check. King g8. And here white checkmates black's king in one move by three different ways. Please find all of them. Queen g7 mate. Knight h6 mate. And knight e7 mate. Knight f5 check. Pawn takes knight. Queen g5, check. King f8. Queen takes knight, check. And mate in two moves. King e8. Queen f7, check. king d8 and queen d7 mate. Back to the game. Queen e8 was played. Queen e5. It looks as if Capablanca has defended his position rather well. However, his next move, although very natural, allows a surprising combination that has become extremely famous. Queen e7 was played. h6 was necessary to stop any tricks on the king's side. Queen e7. Now follows one of the greatest combinations in chess history. Can you see it? Bishop a3. The bishop wakes up with decisive effect. There are two ideas behind this move: to remove the blockader from in front of the e-pawn and to divert the queen from defending the f6 knight. Black's main defensive idea is to give perpetual check, but white's king can escape. Queen takes bishop. Queen e8 is no good. It follows queen c7 check, king g8, bishop e7, knight g4, queen d7, queen a8, bishop d8, and white wins. Queen takes bishop was played. Knight h5 check, and this is the crucial follow-up. The squares around the black king are now just too weak. Pawn takes knight. If king h6, then knight takes knight, queen c1 check, king f2, queen d2 check, king g3, queen takes c3 check, king h4, and queen takes d4 check fails to the killer blow. Knight g4 checkmate. Back to the game. Knight h5 check. Pawn takes knight. Queen g5 check. King f8. Queen takes knight check. King g8. If king e8, then queen f7 check, king d8, queen d7 is mate. King g8 was played. e7. Ботвенник foresaw that black had no perpetual check. Now white's central strategy triumphs. An elegant king walk brings white the point. Queen c1 check. King f2. The final part of this famous game. The king starts his walk up the board. Queen c2 check. King g3, queen d3 check, king h4, queen e4 check, king takes pawn. The h5 pawn must be removed. Queen e2 check. If queen g6 check, then queen takes queen check, pawn takes queen check, king takes pawn, and the white king stops the black's king from approaching the pawn. And back to the game. Queen e2 check was played. King h4. Queen e4 check. g4. Now possible since black's h5 pawn has been eliminated. Queen e1 check. King h5. With no checks left, Capablanca resigned. This was a strategic battle on the grand scale, culminating with a crucial combination. Capablanca chose an ambitious plan of infiltrating on the queen side at the cost of giving white more prospects in the center. Botvinnik pushed on the center, bravely sacrificing a pawn on the queen side for the initiative. Capablanca defended well, and just when he seemed to be consolidating, Botvinnik found a fantastic combination, and there was no saving the black position. Here, Capablanca didn't fully appreciate the danger of the center. When you see the enemy temporarily misplace his pieces on the one side of the board, a swift response on the other side or through the center is often called for. This game between two world champions is a good example of this. Okay. That's the lesson for today. from Eugene Greene's Chess School. I hope it was useful and you enjoyed it. If so, push likes, subscribe to my YouTube channel and leave comments. Also, you are welcome to set this video to either your own YouTube channel. It happens automatically when pushing likes, or to the social networks such as Facebook. It's important in order to make this video popular. Visit my website greenies.de, where you'll find thousands of useful games. And like in my other videos, all the useful links to the pages of Eugene Greene's Chess School are in the description below the video. Spread the description to see all of them. Thanks for watching. Goodbye.